pleasure to introduce and welcome Captain Raghuraman. Right, his profile reads like a dream. And after having spent 11 years in the army and enthralling audience world over through his Josh talks and TED talks, he's here to address our Great Lakes student body. So I'll just give you a short introduction about Raghuraman, and I would request all the alumni to put in your chat questions after his talk, so we'll be able to interact with him. So on behalf of Great Lake fraternity, it's my absolute privilege to welcome Captain Raghuraman to our alumni meet. Raghuraman is a founder and CEO of NatGrid, a national intelligence grid, was a former president of Reliance Industries and a distinguished fellow of ORF, Observational Research Foundation, which is a global think tank, and also an author of a best-selling book. More about the book later. Raghuram's unique career profile has enabled him to learn, practice, and teach first principles of organizational dynamics, strategy, transformations, and mindset shifts that are needed to lead in a complex and ever-changing world. He has operated in distinctively different environments of leadership, the authoritarian style within the armed forces, an incentive-driven style predominant in corporates such as Mahindra and Reliance, and the procedure-driven bureaucratic style in the government. He has founded and led companies as well as been part of global complex JVs. Raghu has also raised a new hybrid organization within the government, which had personnel from government and private sector working together towards a common mission. Raghu's concepts, writings, and talk sessions on the subjects of leadership, strategy, and entrepreneurship have been inspiring, and he gets mentioned in many national and international media. His talks have been watched over 10 million times and has been used as case studies in several B schools and leadership forums. He's associated with many B schools such as Indian School of Business, Duke Corporation Education, National Defense College, Army War College, to name a few, and has also conducted workshops for global audiences in India, UAE, Singapore, for clients from various industries. Now, Raghu has authored this book called Every Man's War, which has been endorsed by business and government leaders alike. He's now here to talk to us. And thank you, Captain, for accepting our invitation.
Thank you. Welcome
once again. And we really look forward to hearing from you. And we will ask you questions at the end of the session. Right? Over to you now.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. And it's great to meet all of you from a virtual environment. But I guess our whole world is now kind of used to this. I was thinking actually about the session that I wanted to do. So first time when this sort of request came to do a session, I was thinking that it is for the students of Great Lakes. And that's why I had suggested something like deep work. But after, so I logged in about 45 minutes ago, and I was also, sort of absorbing, listening to the founding dean and the other people. And I think the session that I would like to do with you, for you right now, would be different from what I had originally planned. So there's an example of agility on the spot, one of the features that you were looking at. And the session I would like to do with you is titled Leading in a Ruptured World. Not reading in a VUCA world, but leading in a ruptured world, because we are looking at a ruptured world. And I'm not saying this in an abstract sense. I'll be very specific and point out to you why I think some principles of leadership that we need to implement in the world going forward will be dramatically different from what we were doing until now. So I just want to use a presentation more for my reference to share that. Let me just share this screen. 1 second. Can you see the screen in front of you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So we are in business. Now, what we're going to discuss is, what is this ruptured world? Some first principles of leadership which we can rely on during paradigm shifts. A framework that will help us for leading in this kind of a fractured, ruptured world, and what opportunities actually arise during a paradigm shift. So let me begin by using this phrase that VUCA has turned into rupt. Now, when I was doing this session, I was doing it for Masters Union in Delhi, a bunch of MBA students. One of them actually popped up and said, sir, with great difficulty, we had memorized the acronym VUCA. Now you have gone ahead and changed it to RUPT. So it's not me who's changed it. It is the CDC. And incidentally, the acronym RUPT, which I think describes the current situation much better, was coined 2 years before. It was coined well before the COVID. So it was almost a premonition in some sense. Now, RUPT, by the way, interestingly, anecdotally, R-U-P-T, RUPT is the Latin root for the word break, to explode. That is why you have it in erupt, interrupt, eruption, rupture. That's where the root comes from. But in this case, we are talking about RUPT in the acronym of R standing for rapid. Now, let me explain to you my favorite example of rapidity with which situations change in the world today. On the 8th of March last year, 8th of March, I was in Goa with Infosys BPM. And Infosys had just crossed, doing a very similar keynote talk there. They had crossed $1 billion in revenue. Their CEO, old friend, was very, very happy that all his leaders were there. And he was telling me very proudly that, Raghu, all my leaders are here with me for the first time, except for some who have not come from China. Because in China, there is some fever or some virus is going on because of which they could not come. This was the 8th of March. And you know what happened in India on 24th of March. In less than 10, 12 working days, a problem which was at the other end of the world, some remote, you know, butterfly flapping its wings somewhere in the other side of the world, created a cyclone in our world that we have never, ever seen before. The uncertainty used to be there in VUCA also. U standing for uncertainty, but now the uncertainty has become far more exacerbated. Let me give this to you again with an example that you'll relate with. Suppose I ask you, are you free for, say, lunch day after tomorrow? You might be able to tell me yes or no. But if I ask you for a meeting time 10 days from now, you're not very sure. Because the horizon of planning, which used to all the family vacations, we have alumni meets, going off with school reunions, anything that you were earlier planning, which you could plan for 6 months, 8 months, do tickets booking in advance, hotel booking in advance, for all that advanced planning in our world is now reduced to a few hours. It's come to 72 hours, 108 hours. That's the way the planning is actually happening, in days, not even in weeks. Paradoxical is interesting because in the world that we will face, I don't think leaders will be having the luxury of taking a decision between a right and a wrong. I think increasingly leaders will have to take decision between one right and another right, or one wrong and another wrong. I'll give you a couple of examples. I mean, we can see these examples around us. So do you lock down a country the size of India with just 4 hours notice? Yes, that will cause a lot of misery. But what if you gave 4 days to do that? What would that do? What would it happen, the roads getting jammed and people fleeing from one location to another location, people trying to get back over there, how many accidents would happen, So every decision that leaders will have to take right now, another decision that you might, many of you might have encountered, again, I'm keeping it to COVID so that we can correlate with it, that many of you might have wondered, why did the government relax the restrictions during Diwali? The Diwali time, there was so much of crowd, especially in North India, and one might wonder that we had took so much of care, and why did the government not put in restrictions? And again, the rationale there is that many of you might know this, that more than 60% of the sales of SMEs and MSMEs happens during the Diwali weekend. And for a nation that had been hit with COVID, where livelihoods have been lost for 9-10 months, if you also close down that 60% sales window that 1 week, it could. So many times, in a simple term, what leaders will have to get used to now is always having a dissatisfied part of their demography or dissatisfied part of their stakeholders, because most of the solutions that leaders will take in a paradigm shift environment or in a crisis environment will always have one part of the stakeholders feeling that it was not a good decision. The last one is tangled. And this is interesting because in the beginning of this lockdown, I was part of a committee which was set up to evaluate what should be essential services. And you will all agree, communications topped the list, because without communications, you can't even do governance. You can't even move around resources. So communications is essential service. But if communication is essential service, then the 4-5 lakh odd towers that are set up all over our country, they become essential services. Now, many of you might be aware that half of these towers are not powered by dedicated power lines. They are diesel generators, the integral power, which means diesel becomes essential service. Now, diesel supply chain relies on trucks which have to move across the country to transport the fuel, which means the roadways where the dhabas, the restaurant, they become essential services. Each one of these towers has got a radio modem and a router, which has to be constantly adjusted. That's why your signal strength keeps going up and down. Sometimes new tower comes up, it has to be readjusted, which means these young engineers become essential services who will climb up this tower and adjust it. These young engineers, most of them are bachelors. They live in chambaris and in paying guest accommodation, and they eat in cafeterias and restaurants. Everything becomes essential services. So suddenly you realize that life does not move in convenient silos of green, amber, and red. Life moves through each one of these zones in a very, very tangled manner. I think this slide, which I made actually about 6 months ago, encapsulates the way the world has turned upside down. A company whose name most of us were not familiar with, Zoom. I mean, of course, we knew Cisco, Telepresence, FaceTime, Skype, GoTo, Team Meeting, all. But suddenly, a company who was not really, I mean, it was a unicorn even earlier, but suddenly moves from a 1 billion valuation and comes to a valuation which is far more. By the way, this is this headline is in June, so you can imagine what has happened now. And another company, which was the darling of the Wall Street Journal, and had this whole thing about WeWork. Every city had it. You saw so many of them all around. Their value just evaporated. And that happened in a space of less than 6 months. That's the topsy-turvy nature of the world that we are going to be encountering when we go ahead. Whenever there is a paradigm shift, there is also an opportunity for us to go back to the drawing board and question our first principles. I want to give you this example. It's one of my favorite examples taken from Professor Tina Seelig. I've tried it in many of my sessions, and I'm sure some of the faculty here should try it with the students as well. What she does is she tells her students that I'm going to give you $5 of seed funding. In my case, in India, I used 500 rupees and 2 hours of time. And with this $5 of seed funding and 2 hours of time, you have to come up with a business plan that can generate maximum revenue, and you will get a 3-minute slot to present in front of the Stanford alumni. Now, as you can imagine, many of the students would immediately start thinking about how to take this seed funding of $5. They buy eggs and make boiled eggs, or you know, some of them buy material for car wash and they wash cars or whatever. And they make some money out of that. There's only so much you can do in 2 hours of time. Some of the students, a smaller number of the students, realizes that perhaps this $5 is a red herring. And they reframe the question to say, what would we do in 2 hours of time to generate maximum revenue if we had no money? And what they hit upon is ideas like going to restaurants that are always packed, jam-packed, especially during the weekends, and book reservations there, and then sell those reservations at a premium when couples come who want to go inside the restaurant. And in this case, they don't even use the $5. They actually generate more money in those 2 hours without using those $5. But a very tiny minority who understand the concepts of first principles realize that actually it's not one resource they have, $5. It's not even two resources they have, $5 and 2 hours. It's three resources they have. They also have 3 minutes in front of the Stanford alumni, and they auction that 3-minute slot to MNCs who want to come and make a pitch to the Stanford alumni. Now, this anecdotal, almost anecdotal and almost humorous example illustrates that many times when we are dealt with new cards in a new environment, our old thinking, old wiring will keep taking us back to that $5, will keep making us think that that is our limiting factor. Whereas in a crisis, in a paradigm shift that we are going through right now, there are many, many opportunities that open up. And if we as leaders don't spot those opportunities, then newcomers in the block will do a pole vault and cross us over and leverage those opportunities. I want to share with you about 5 or 6 principles which I have found in my 35 years of experience as something that stands in really good stead, especially when we are going through crises or especially when the world is going through a paradigm shift. And let me begin with the first one. This is something that we need to understand really, really well. that the map is not the territory. What does that mean? So all of you probably recognize this map, and I'm sure many of you would have also used it. This is the London Tube map, the iconic map, basis of which pretty much every metro and subway map has been made in the world. Now, this is a really good map. It's very, very useful. Matter of fact, you can navigate the entire London in the underground through this and plan your journey and all of that stuff. But if you're trying to use this map over the ground, it would be a disaster. Matter of fact, even the engine driver does not use this map to navigate in the underground. So a map is only an abstracted version of the reality. What I mean by that is every map that we had been used to, every principle of management, leadership is a contact sport, Marshall Goldsmith's mantra, now there is no contact, very limited contact possible. Every map that we have used in the past, the number of weeks it takes for us to do an assessment, number of months it takes us for us to roll out an offer letter, the number of months it takes to, all of those maps will have to be reconsidered in a ruptured world. And if we try to stick on, many of us will, many of the older leaders will try to stick on to the older maps because we are familiar with that map, we might find ourselves in a very similar situation as a passenger would, who would be using the London Undertube underground map to try and navigate over the ground. The second point I think is extremely important, and I'm saying this with my experience of advising and working with companies over the last 13, 14 months, ever since the pandemic set in. We will have to reconstruct leadership that is contactless ground up. Let me explain that to you. This is a very, very important and a nuanced point. You can't take what happens in the real world and convert it into a Zoom platform and think that you have ported the efficiency of the real world over here. Actually, it'll have to be reconstructed. Let me explain to you why. When I'm doing a review in, say, Reliance, and it's a day-long meeting, which happens, I'm sure many of us have sat through such day-long meeting, working lunch and all of that, and my North Zone head gets up to speak, I don't just look at his face. I also look at the face of the South Zone head. I look at the face of the number two guy. I look at the face of that youngster who's wanting to say something but is hesitating, and I have the leeway, I have the leadership tools to be able to say, okay, fine, I want to hear somebody who's not yet spoken and point to that young guy and say, what do you have in your mind? Let's hear something, and give him that leeway. I have the opportunity that if I rebuke somebody during that meeting to tap him on the back later on, say, don't worry, that happens, don't worry about it and all that. You have the ability to have side conversations. Remember one thing, a lot of the organization's work actually doesn't get done in ERPs and mails. It gets validated in ERPs and mails. What actually happens in conversations in corridors, in staircases, in canteens, when you're out for a smoke, that is when a lot of the fluidity happens. So if we assume that whatever we used to do in the real world, if we just port it to Zoom, you cannot substitute duplex communication with simplex communication. Let me explain what that means. Duplex is a military term, but duplex communication means what you would do in a normal conference. People would be speaking, they'll be talking to each other, there'll be side conversations that will be happening. Simplex communication is what we are doing right now. When I press the radio switch to speak, the entire network gets jammed. No one else can speak. Exactly what is happening right now. When I am speaking, nobody else can speak, and it becomes a single strand of information instead of multiple channels of information. You cannot take a world which used to function with multiple channels of information and transform it into a single channel information and think it'll be the same efficiency. So I think we will have to redesign many of our protocols of leadership, many of our protocols of communication, of team bonding, ground up. We cannot simply port it in the real world, from the real world to the virtual world, by simply creating a platform like Zoom and saying, let's talk on Zoom. This is an example that I learned many, many years ago, and I found it to be one of the most powerful tools for leaders. It might sound very simple, and let me give this to you with an example, a live example. So in every army unit, there is an appointment called the adjutant. Think of the adjutant as a EA to the, actually EA plus plus to the CEO. He is the person around whom the entire unit hinges in terms of coordination and all of that. And, you know, so visualize that, and the adjutant has to work very hard. He wakes up somebody 5:30 in the morning, goes to sleep at some 11:30 at night, 12. And let's say a patrol which had gone out to, let's say, Malerkotla, which is a location in Punjab, and it was scheduled to come back at 12 o'clock at night. Now, what will happen is, as soon as this patrol enters the garrison, the first call will come from the garrison gate sentry. He'll call the adjutant and he'll say, Sahab, jo gaadiyan which had gone for the patrol, they have come in inside. They have clocked in. They have come in into the... 10, 15 minutes later, the adjutant will get another call. This call will be from the motor transport NCO, who will inform the same thing. He said the vehicles which had gone for the patrol, they have come back. 10 to 15 minutes later, he'll get a third call. That call will come from the armory NCO, the one who manages the armory, where the weapons and ammunition are kept. And he'll call up and he'll say the patrol which had gone has come back. And after 15, 20 minutes of that, you will get another call, which will be the patrol leader, who will say that, you know, we had to go, it has come. Now, if you have gone to sleep at 11, 11:30 after a long, hard day, and you're woken up at 12 by the first call, you dozed off and suddenly you're woken up by the second call, you might be irritated and you might say, yeah, I know, yeah, they come back. You know, I know that. That might be the response. We are trained never to do that. We are trained that every call has a specific purpose. The first call which is coming in, the gate sentry is informing exactly at what time the patrol entered inside the garrison. The second call, the motor transport NCO is confirming that the vehicle stuck to the route, which was on the plan, because the odometer and the plan matches, and the vehicles are in proper condition, no accident, no damage, and they can be reused tomorrow morning in an emergency if required. The armory NCO is confirming that all the ammunition and weapons have been deposited. There's no loss of ammunition, no loss of weapon, and the soldiers haven't taken the weapons to the barracks with them thinking, kal jama kar, we'll deposit it tomorrow, because that's completely against the SOP. And when the patrol leader is giving his final briefing, the previous three calls act as an audit mechanism. Matter of fact, good adjutants, trained adjutants, they will go off to sleep after the first call. And within about 15, 20 minutes, they don't get the second call. They'll wake up because they'll know something is wrong. During a crisis, it is every leader's job. I'm specifying it. It's every leader's job to make anybody who calls and gives them information feel really good about it, even if you already know that information. Even if you already know that. Never diss a person by saying, I know about it. Always make the, yeah, okay, really, thanks a ton for letting me. Always make the person feel happy that they are communicating with you. If you follow this one rule, you will find your information channels multiplying exponentially. And that, as you are aware, is one of the most important aspects of leadership. Remember one thing, I used to run an organization which used to focus on information security. And I would often tell CEOs this, that your information leaking away to some other company will damage you a little bit. But what is causing you colossal damage is your own information not getting back to you. And this is one of the most important aspects during a crisis. To ensure that people are communicating, you must make them feel happy. Don't ever say, call me anytime you want, and diss him the first time he calls. You have to make people feel elated when they speak to you. This is a very important story and an interesting story. And I narrate this because I recognize the blue chip audience I'm speaking to. And blue chips have many, many advantages, but they also have sometimes a flaw. Sometimes we, because of our achievements, we have done this, we have done that, we've topped there, we worked with this MNC, we worked over there. We get a sense of what I call a little bit of an intellectual arrogance. So I think it's extremely important in a crisis or in any, by the way, none of these rules that I'm talking about are valid only in a crisis. They are good for any time, but during a crisis, they play a much more amplified role. I think we must also have the humility to relearn again. And let me tell you this story. It's my favorite story on relearning and on intellectual humility. And I'm sure after you hear this story, many of you will make it your favorite story. So this happened about 18, 20 years ago, well before the era of smartphones. There was a friend of mine who was an IAS officer. He was posted in Ambalapura, which, as many of you might be knowing, is a district in Kerala. And much of his community over there was the fishing community, these fishermen who'd go into the high seas. So in one particular year, my friend had some surplus funds. So what he did was, with those funds, he bought his fisherman GPSs, Garmin GPSs. Remember, this is before the smartphone. So most of the fishermen did not know what a GPS is, and they're trying to figure out what it is. But in the end, they figured it out. They figured out what a GPS is. But the thing is, my educated friend had given them these GPSs, thinking that in case of a storm or in case of bad weather or whatever, they'll be able to navigate back. Now, he forgot that these fishermen are the progeny of thousands of years of fish going, sea going fishermen. They don't need a bloody GPS. They can look at the clouds. They can look at the water and the birds or whatever, and they can figure out their way to come. Many of you who are from Kerala know this, that most of the sons of the soil and backwaters can actually swim before they can walk. So for them, it's a complete waste of money. Or so we thought. But this is what the fishermen did. They would go to the fish market. They would take the rotting vegetables, rotting fish. I mean, you know the fish market, the garbage of that place. They would take all of that garbage. They would stuff it in gunny sacks, in sacks. And they would take it into the deep sea and they would drop it there and mark that spot with the GPS. And next day when they came over there, they would find the place teeming with fish which has been attracted by the garbage. Now, my educated, erudite friend bought them a technology so that they could navigate back home. And my illiterate country cousins used the very same technology to go out into the sea, lower the number of trips that they had to do, reduce carbon footprint, manage the market supply demand in a much more structured manner. We must always have the humility to relearn from any source. Just because it's not coming from Harvard or Yale or Stanford or Great Lakes does not mean that it could not be a killer idea. Keep your eyes open, but more than your eyes, keep your mind open with the humility to learn from anybody. I heard the word agility a few times during this session, and I know it's a buzzword which people like to use, but let me try and show you a structural example of what it really means, what agility and creative thinking really means. What you're seeing over here is the high jump. It's one of the three words in the Olympic logo: stronger, higher, faster. And till 1968 Olympics, the high jump was always attempted by the runner coming running, leaping with his leg up front, the first leg, and then the second leg, and then leaping like you do hurdles, or like we jump over walls, like kids jump over a wall. They come running and they just jump over the wall. That's the way high jump used to be done. 1968, a 21-year-old civil engineer student, Dick Fosbury. Many of you may have heard the story. Most of you would know one part of the story, but there is a subtle nuance which I want to tell you. He comes and he changes the way that the high jump is done, and he does the jump the way it's being shown in this picture. It's not his picture, but this is the way the jump is done. It's called the Fosbury flop, in which you come running, the athlete comes running towards the pole and leaps in a sideway manner, puts the head across first, shoulders, torso, and the legs. Complete opposite of what used to happen before. And this revolutionized the sport. Not just was he able to break the Olympic record, but this became the format of the high jump. And ever since 1968, 90% of the high jump world records have been done using the Fosbury flop. Now, many of you may have heard this story. There are some lessons to be taken from this part of the story, that a 21-year-old civil engineer, not some athlete produced out of the great Russian athlete factory or the American or the Chinese athlete factory, a very non-descript student comes and does this. But the more nuanced part of it is something that we need to be aware of. What was also happening in the 60s was the landing surfaces were changing. Instead of the traditional sand pit that was dug, which is what you and I must have used in school. Remember when you do high jump or something, there is just a sand pit that is dug over there. That was being replaced by foam mattresses. Dick Fosbury was not only looking at the pole, he was also looking at what changes happened in the environment of the landing surface. Now, in a sand pit, you cannot take the risk of landing with your neck, but in a foam mattress, you can. So when environment changes, true agility comes, not by doing things faster, not by saying earlier I used to do it in 8 days, now I'll do it in 3 days, so I become agile. That is not agility. That is just doing stuff in a hurried manner. Agility is when, mental agility is when you are able to look around the environment and say, hey, wait a minute. These two things have changed. Customer behavior has changed. Customers now no longer need to be with the salesperson. Doctor-patient relationship has changed. Patients don't really need to be with the doctors anymore. Work can be outsourced. People are now comfortable dealing with somebody on Zoom. They might as well deal with somebody in Zoom in Latin America, where the cost of labor would be 1/4 of what it is in India. The environment is changing. That is mental agility. The point I lead from mental agility is if you want to have creativity, innovation, engagement, then you have to create as leaders a psychologically safe environment. What does that mean? Let me explain that to you. So many of you may have heard of this experiment. It's called the Marshmallow Tower Experiment. If you haven't heard of it, just YouTube it and you'll see thousands of videos which tell you what it is. So fundamentally, it is about giving a group of 8 to 10 people about 20 sticks. They use spaghetti, I use broomstick, you can use anything, and some duct tape and a piece of marshmallow. In the traditional experiment, I use thermocol, you can use anything again. The idea is that this group of 10 to 15 people have to construct the highest possible tower using this material in about 10 to 15 minutes, time limit is given. And this experiment has been done with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different cohorts. It's been done with CEOs, management trainees, MBA students, doctors, kindergarten kids, pilots, firefighters, army. I mean, it's been done across the world. And some very interesting organizational dynamics comes out of it. So by the way, the ones who perform the worst, sad to tell you, are young MBA interns. And there is a reason for that. The reason will become very apparent in a bit. The ones who do second best, incidentally, are architects and builders, you know, and engineers. So that's good because they are the ones who are building our towers and all that. So if they can't build a marshmallow tower. But the ones who beat everyone, the group that beats everyone hands down is, as some of you might have guessed, the kindergarten kids. Now, organizational behavior experts have identified why this happens. The reason why this happens is that when adults get together, when young management MBA trainees get together or CEOs get together, they first look at the task and then they divide the task. They say, okay, you will be the group who will design this. I'll be the group who will do this. They do that task division. They do a lot of what is called status management, managing the status within the group. So somebody will say, you know, I used to work with brigade builders and so I know about building and all of this, you know, ego, this, that. Or kindergarten kids don't care. They don't care about, you know, the annual confidential report, 360 degree evaluation, Gallup survey. They don't care about that. They are just mission focused. They'll push around someone. They'll take the piece if they want from somebody else. They'll pop in with an idea and all of that stuff. Because they are in an entirely psychologically safe environment. If you want to see an example of a psychologically unsafe environment, in any meeting conference room, when a person speaks and then looks at the CEO to see what the CEO is saying, or thinking about what he said, that is a psychologically unsafe environment. In that environment, you can never ever thrive in a crisis, because in a crisis, you need three things as a leader. First thing, you need an accurate picture of what is happening on the ground. If customers are moving away, if dealers are not replacing orders, if there is a resentment about the product in the market, you better come to know of it the soonest possible. If curriculum is too static, it is not shifting, market is asking for something else, B schools are creating it, it's best that you know the bad news as soon as possible. Scared troops will never tell you bad news. It is only psychologically safe troops who will tell you the news as it is. The second is that during a crisis, you need every person on deck working with their highest form of creativity towards the mission. In a psychologically safe environment, all the people will work highly creatively to safeguard their own jobs because they are unsafe. They don't know what's going to happen. So they'll first guard their domain, their satrapi, their area, and not the institution's area, not the organization's area of the mission. And third, in a crisis, the situation is always very fluid. And in a fluid situation, the leader on the spot has to take decisions on the spot. He doesn't have time to check in headquarter. He or she will have to take a decision on the spot, and only empowered, only psychologically safe troops will feel like taking a decision. Psychologically unsafe people will constantly say, let me CYA and check with my superior, who will check with the superior, who will check with the superior. And by the time the instruction comes back, the opportunity has been lost. So it is imperative, existential for leaders at all levels to ensure that in their environment of influence, they are creating a psychologically safe environment and not a psychologically unsafe environment. This is very, very counterintuitive, because during a crisis, what happened? Many of the authoritative, we have been in a lockdown for the last 12 months. Now in the next quarter, we got to make it happen. Do you know headquarters has told us if we don't do it, there'll be head cutting, which will happen. This is not a good idea. Scared troops will always have low morale, and you can never ever go into battle with low morale troops and expect to win. So creating a psychologically safe environment, I think, will be one of the crucial and critical leadership aspects at this stage. I want to also share a story with you, which I think can teach us a lot. My fundamental premise that crises are when leadership is really brought forth. You know, like it's like a knife, you know. So a knife is used to cut vegetables and cut fruits and cut butter. But a knife cannot become sharp by cutting butter. So if somebody says that I'm a good leader during, you know, when good times, but during bad times, I'm not a good leader. So actually, during good times, a leader is not required. At that time, an Excel sheet or a clown can run the organization. It is when the order books are down. It is when there is despair. It is when there is no light at the end of the tunnel. There's another tunnel at the end of the tunnel. That is the time that leadership is really required. So crisis is where the leadership is sharpened. Well, knife is always sharpened on a stone, never on a vegetable, never on a butter. And I want to tell you the story of a crisis and how we can learn from that. And this is the story of 2611, one of the stories of 2611. And many of you might remember the incident happened 12, 13 years ago. And for those of you who are too young to remember it, I'm sure you would have read about it. Movies are being made about it now and all of that stuff. But anyway, the slide that you see in front of you, you see the team which is called the NSG, the National Security Guard. Those of you who are from Gurgaon or have visited Gurgaon know that their headquarters is in Manesar. Now, this is India's elite counter-terror force. Tell you some very interesting things about it, which you may not know. The first is that this is a completely deputationist force, which means that every soldier who comes into this outfit comes in only for 2 years, and he comes in from multiple cultures. He'll come in from Jat, Maratha, Gurkha, any one of the infantry battalions, he'll come in. And after the 90 days of probation, of training and evaluation and assessment, if accepted, he then becomes part of the NSG, and regardless of what his culture is, where he comes from, which battalion he comes from, he becomes thereafter to be known as the Black Cat. That's it. Now, every special forces unit has got what is called a hot standby. Matter of fact, every army unit has got what is called a QRT. QRT is quick reaction team. And this is usually a team that is kept on hot standby, weapons locked and loaded to be launched into the operation in a moment's notice. And we have a 4 hour shift. And after 4 hours, another team comes, another team. So 365/24/7, there is a team ready to respond. Now, some of you might remember that on the night of 26/11, which was Wednesday, this team was mobilized to Palam Airport, which is their jump off point.
Stop it right now. You don't know what's here.
Karthik wanted me to stop it right now. Okay. So, where was I?
Palam Airport.
Yeah. So, they reached Palam Airport, and then you might remember that they were kept waiting there for 14 hours because the airlift happened the next day. So let me put that in context for you. Let's say you have been told that you have to take a...
His phone was...
Sorry.
You have to make a career make or break presentation tomorrow to your global MD, to your global CEO, to the education minister. And you're told the presentation will start at 9 o'clock in the morning, then told 9:05, 9:15, 9:45, 10:15, 10:45, 11 o'clock. Nobody is telling you you can go back home and come at 6 o'clock in the evening. You've been constantly kept on tenterhooks throughout those 14 hours. And after 14 hours, when you're launched into the battle, you are told it is not one target. It is not two targets. It is three targets. Taj, Chabad and Oberoi, three distinct buildings that have to be neutralized with the force, the drill, the SOP, the inventory, the officer to men ratio, the signal circuits, training, rehearsals, everything done for one mission at a time. No special forces in the unit has ever trained that they will have to do three independent missions at the same time. And yet this unit was able to expand like an amoeba and create three different teams and conduct these three distinct missions independently of each other. And many of you may not know this, that all the 168 odd people who died during 26/11 died before the NSG took over. From the time the NSG took over the mission, only deaths that happened were the nine terrorists and the two commandos who died. Now, question could be asked, how did they do this? So I am not one of those motivational speakers who tells if soldiers are standing in Siachen, you can also do it. There's no logic in that, right? I am trying to explain to you a framework for which you don't have to join the NSG. You can do it actually, not just in your places of work. You can even do it at home. And I think you need to do it at home. Let me explain that framework to you. This framework is called the two up, two down framework. I will first explain the framework. Then I'll explain a nuance about the framework, which I think is extremely important. And then I'll remind you why this framework is extremely important, not just in your professional life, but also perhaps in your personal life. The framework is called two up, two down, which essentially means that every leader at every level must be fully capable, the first up, fully capable of taking on a role one above him, and must have him or her, must have crystal clarity about the strategic intent of the level above that. So let me explain to you in a simpler way. Let's say I'm the vice president HR in a company, and I'm dealing currently with LNOD and talent acquisition or campus engagements or whatever. This is my portfolio. I must be fully capable of taking on the CHRO's role at a drop of a hat. And I must have crystal clarity about the global CHRO's strategic intent and my CEO's strategic intent at any given point in time. The two down means I must be capable of taking on one role below me, which has fallen vacant because of whatever reason. So I can just roll up my sleeve and say, I will handle that. What we call a one and a half portfolio. I heard the founding dean also referred to that in terms of two jobs or something. But this is a one and a half portfolio concept where I will do my entire job and also be capable of taking on a half portfolio more. And the second down means I will have crystal clarity about the ground reality of my soldiers so that I do not pass an instruction which just cannot be obeyed on ground. This two up, two down framework is not taught in some academy in the institution. There is no training team which comes and does this. This is done at every individual's level, and it's done in a proactive manner. What does that mean? So as a captain, my job is to constantly keep asking my company commander, who's a major, that why did you take this decision? Why are you doing this? And okay, so you selected this. I have to constantly take that information out of him. My major's responsibility, my company commander's responsibility, is to take me along in the meetings that he is going to, have me as a fly on the wall, explain the rationale of why a certain decision was taken. It is an individual's responsibility. It's not the responsibility of the organization to make this two up, two down. It is the individual's responsibility at every level. And in case you thought this was only meant for the NSG or meant only for your organization as a business, think about the family. Just think about it. How many families had even briefed their children that in case due to COVID something happened to your parents, where should you go? Who is the uncle you can trust? Where are the papers kept? Where is the finance kept? How many of us, despite facing death during COVID, actually took the pains to draw out our will, to put down the financial order in place, to get the documents of the house all in order, to have the safety depository box. So I think this two up, two down framework is not just applicable in a professional life, it's also applicable in a personal life. And more importantly, it is an individual's responsibility, not an organizational fatwa which will come from top. It is something that has to go from bottom up. So the world has indeed changed. There's no doubt about it. The world has turned upside down. But something strange has also happened in this world. This is an article that came out in June, which talked about of hundreds of companies which are thriving and doing exceedingly well in the pandemic. The world changes. And when the world changes, there will be huge opportunities that will come out of this change as well. I don't want to repeat a cliche, but it'll only be those who are mentally agile, mentally mobile, who have the ability to create a psychologically safe environment, who have the ability to inspire team during times of crisis, who will be able to leverage what is promising, as always, at the end of every paradigm shift, going to be a completely new space for completely new blue ocean for growth, expansion. And of course, during paradigm shifts, you will also see a lot of dinosaurs become extinct. So with that, I come to the end of my specific presentation per se. But if there are any questions, any ideas, thoughts, I'd be happy to try and answer them.
That was absolutely riveting, Captain. You just kept us glued on totally, and I've been receiving a lot of chat messages and some questions we have. So I'm going to start with the first question, which is probably a rather obvious one, and you may have got asked this several times. There is a certain awe that we attach to people from the services. As lay people and outside, we do believe that the army people have a certain selflessness and dedication that they bring to work. So my question is, how do we kind of inculcate this kind of a selfless stroke dedication in a corporate culture, especially when the motive is not necessarily a greater good all the time? In army, it's obvious that it's a greater good. But how do we kind of replicate this in a corporate culture? Related to that, my second question is, once people leave the army and the services and get into a normal civilian life, how do you continue with that work ethic, which is again very inspiring for the rest of us, right? So both questions.
So let me answer the first question. It might come as a surprise to you. By the way, when I do a session, I do one of the sessions, which is called Leadership at 26,000 Feet, in which I usually ask the students and the alumni or the people who are listening, why do you think a soldier fight? Why do you think a soldier fights? And invariably, the answers I get is, national pride for the flag, for the country, for a sense of selflessness, blah, 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 all of those things. Then I put up the map of India. And I ask these extremely bright attendees that, can someone point out where is Siachen Glacier in this map? Because if you believe he is fighting for you, it's only logical to say, yeah, you're far more educated than an average soldier. You should know at least where he is fighting. So, you know what the answer usually is. So now, if an educated person who does not know where Siachen Glacier is assuming that the soldier is fighting for the nation, that is the wrong assumption. Matter of fact, I'll tell you, most of our soldiers come from very, very small hamlets and villages. A boy from Kashmir has never seen Kanyakumari, he's never seen the sea. A boy from Tamil Nadu doesn't know what the desert looks like. A boy from Rajasthan doesn't know what a jungle is. They don't have a concept of some massive nation. You know what soldiers fight for? They fight for the comrades who are with them in the trench. They fight for that young leader who is leading them, that lieutenant who is leading them. Yeah. And they fight for the badge which they wear on their shoulder. These are the only three things with which not just the Indian army, but most armies of the world take their troops into certain death at times. At times it is certain death. They take them. Only these three tools. A camaraderie between the troops, the inspiring leader, that young leader, not some general sahab, that lieutenant will say, follow me, come with me. Main leke jaunga, sala zinda leke aunga wapas. That leader and the honor of the Palatan. These are the three tools. By the way, these three tools are available to everybody. These three tools were available to Titan when they decided to make the world's thinnest watch. These tools were available to Tata when they decided to make the world's cheapest car. These tools are available to every corporate. I think a leader shirks from her responsibility when she asks for a larger purpose. The leader is the purpose. It is the job of the leader to create that purpose. It is not the job of a leader to ask for a purpose to be delivered from top. It doesn't work that way. So that is the answer to the first question. The second, I think, is when you go through a rigor for 20 years, or even 2 years or 5 years to a certain extent, by the way, it introduces a sense of wiring in your brain. I'll tell you a very interesting anecdote, which may not seem directly connected with this, but one of the first things, if you want to be, one of the first steps, if you want to be taken seriously as a leader, is just to stand straight. What does that mean? What is the connection between standing? I'll tell you what the connection is. This story is from The 12 Rules of Life by Jordan Peterson. And he starts his book with this. He starts this book with the story of two lobsters fighting. And he tells why he's chosen lobsters. He says, I have chosen lobsters because they are 300 million years old. So they predate the dinosaurs by a couple of 100 million years.
Okay.
That's how old they are. And so when two lobsters come into the, they're very territorial animals, by the way, when they come and face each other in the ocean bed, they go through a 4-stage confrontation process. The first stage of the process is that both of these lobsters will secrete a liquid into the water. This liquid, like dogs used to sniff, this liquid will tell the other lobster the age, the size, the aggressive nature, the sex, the everything about the other lobster. So the weaker lobster has an option, first fail safe of backing off. If the second stage starts, both the lobsters will brandish their claws. They'll make their size bigger. And you've seen other animals do it, or men also do it. You know, you see them in road and all that stuff. They'll do that, that brandishing with each other. That is the second stage where nature, by the way, does not want in survival of the fittest to have the fights constantly going on. And there's a reason for that. The reason for that is, let's say two alpha lions fight each other. Even the winner, if it's wounded, will die because it can't hunt. It's got a injured foot. So the gene pool will be finished for both of them. And that is why nature has designed this four-stage process. The third stage is when the lobsters will actually grapple their claws together and test each other's strength. And fourth stage is when they'll fight to the finish. Now, interesting thing what happens is the lobster that loses this battle, the serotonin level in the brain of the lobster, they also have serotonin, it goes down. It goes down because it tells that lobster that you are lower in the totem pole, so don't go around taking panga with lobsters that are stronger than you. So it makes that lobster weaker in order for the lobster to live. Otherwise, the lobster might go into another fight and get killed over there. Human beings also have serotonin levels, and human beings also go down in self-esteem whenever they are downcast, when they are hit by, you know, all of those things. Now, we'll park this story on one side and I'll tell you another story and connect them together and then connect it to your question. You might have noticed that whenever we win a race, we run and we finish the race, we do the yay like that. This victory sign, we do this, right? Mm-hmm. Blind people do it also. People who have never seen anyone else do it, they also do it. This is called a two-way kinesthetic action, which means when you are elated, you feel like doing this. But when you do like this, you feel elated. The first rule of standing straight is to have a sense of presence in your own self, to have a sense of self-esteem, to have a sense that I need to take pride in the way I look, the uniform that I wear, the shave that I do every day, the preparation. Now, this is drilled into you for days and days and years and years and years when you're in the service. And therefore, when you move out of the service also, for most of the people, not that they aren't exceptions, there are exceptions everywhere, but for most of the people, that drill, the muscle memory carries forward. And that's the reason why you see that many of those habits and many of those, I really won't label them as work ethics, but many of those habits you will find carrying into. And again, this is not just the prerogative of soldiers. Anybody can do this. Anybody can create that sense of discipline and a sense of routine and a sense of self-esteem for themselves.
So let me just ask a question raised by Saurajit. Saurajit wants to know how to train for two up, two down, right? In an organizational context.
Good question. Good question. So, I'll tell you.
And relatedly, I would also like to add, all of us understand crisis is a true test of a leader, but how do we prepare students for adversity or crisis management? You know, which that makes it look real preparation.
Good. So the thing is, let me answer the second question first. How do you prepare for basketball if you don't have a basketball court? You have a basketball court available to you only once a week, and you are competing with another college which has a in-home, inside the college, a basketball court. How do you prepare? The thing is, 80% of basketball is stamina, coordination, hand-eye coordination, endurance, quick ability to turn in physical agility and teamwork, knowing how the team plays. Let's assume that we focus on drills, battle drills, which train a person on these qualities. Then even if you get once a week that quote, it's absolutely okay. More interestingly, these 80% of the skills are common, whether you're doing basketball, football, volleyball, handball, pretty much any ball sport played in a team. So when you are preparing your teams for a crisis, you don't prepare them by saying fire crisis ke liye ek alag hoga, earthquake crisis ke liye alag hoga, flood ke liye alag hoga, जॉब लॉस के लिए अलग होगा. दैट्स नॉट द वे यू प्रिपेयर फॉर क्राइसिस. फॉर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर क्राइसिस यू गो बैक टू बेसिक ड्रिल्स. बेसिक ड्रिल्स, हाउ क्विकली कैन योर असेसर्स असेस द मार्केट अपॉर्चुनिटी, हाउ क्विकली कैन योर सेल्स टीम टर्न अराउंड अ प्रपोजल, हाउ क्विकली कैन यू कस्टमाइज द सॉल्यूशंस दैट यू हैव डिजाइन बट नाउ द कस्टमर रिक्वायर्स अ डिफरेंट सॉल्यूशन, हाउ क्विकली कैन योर इंटरनल प्रोसेसेस मूव इन टर्म्स ऑफ हायरिंग 20 पीपल इफ यू रिक्वायर देम अर्जेंटली फॉलोइंग ऑल द गवर्नेंसेस एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट स्टफ. How quickly can you improve your battle drills? If you improve your battle drills, by the way, one of the best ways to train a battalion which is going to go through crisis is to just train them. Just put them in training again and again and again. And so what are the special forces? So think about it this way. In the Indian Army of 1.2 million men, there would be less than maybe 15,000 special forces. Now, what is special about the special forces? Not that they get paid more or they get fed more. No. They get trained more. There is much, much higher degrees of training for them, and there are much higher benchmarks for them. And if you do that, even in your own team, if you set up a much higher benchmark and say, because it's a crisis, we are going to tackle this in a faster way, in a happy manner, not in a punitive manner, but in a happy manner, to say that we are going to leverage this opportunity and go up and train them. Train them. Don't talk to them. You have to train them. And one of the most important aspects of the training is to actually do the training with them, to lead them in that training, right? Coming to your first question, which was, just remind me that again.
In terms of leadership crisis is something that you answered, but Saurajit's question was, how do you train for two up, two down?
Two up, two down, yeah. Now that question is, how do you train for swimming?
Yeah.
How do you train for swimming? By reading books?
Put them in the water like penguins do.
So you have to practice it. So if you, at your level, Surajit, next time you're going for a meeting with your boss or with a senior person, have one of your key youngsters come with you. Have him sit on the side. Have him just listening in, making the notes or whatever. Have him listening in. Next time a decision is taken by your boss, which is contrary to your advice, ask, why was that taken? What was the rationale? Explain that to me. Try and find at your level things that you are not actually supposed to do. Not your job. It's not your job, but you're doing it. I actually once narrated a story about this from my own life. How are we for time? You guys are okay for time? Because I don't want to...
Surya, you need to tell us because we are really enjoying this. So you need to tell us.
Yes, ma'am. We are also in time, so we can go ahead. We can...
Okay, great.
All right. So... many years ago, in 2005 or 6, I think, a contingent of four leaders was sent from Mahindra and Mahindra to meet Mr. Michael Bloomberg. What had happened was Mr. Mahindra, Anand Mahindra had met Bloomberg somewhere in one Davos shower or something. They liked each other, shook hands, and they said, we should do some business together. So Mr. Bloomberg said, send a team from your side and we'll see what we can do. Now, this four-man team consisted of Mr. Bharat Doshi, who was then the CFO, now he's an RBI member. The second was Ullas Yargop, who was then the sector president for IT. The third was Vineet Nair, who was then the CEO of Tech Mahindra and Satyam. And the fourth was a young person, relatively junior CEO, relatively of a very small company, fledgling company, 20 odd crores company. And that CEO was selected. And a lot of people asked me, how the hell did you get onto this bandwagon? Kya jack lagaya tune? How did you know it? So the story for that actually goes back a few years ago. So some years ago, I was part of a company called Mahindra Consulting, which was an IT company. And that IT company, like all IT companies, had many divisions. It was an SAP shop. So you had SAP, ABAP, ERP, information security, blah, 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 all of those. And we had a head of communications who one day walked into my office and said that we are going to participate in a NASCOM, some, you know, exhibition or whatever thing, and we need brochures for that. For brochure, we want to describe our services. So can you write me a paragraph of what you do? So I wrote a paragraph of what I do and gave her, this is what we do in information, like any sales brochure, you know, promising the moon and all of that. We did that. After about a week, she came back and gave me the dummy proof and said, "Ki, this is what has come as the proof from the printer. Can you check it?" So I checked it. I found one or two typos. And I was reading it, I started reading the whole brochure and I found that there were typos in other paragraphs also, which also I corrected. And then I realized what was happening was that because 8 different or 9 different people had written this, it was very disjointed. every paragraph would start with, we also do this, we also do this. So I actually just corrected the flow of that and all of that stuff and got it together and, you know, sort of gave it to her. And of course, she must have added huge value to it. And it was given to the printer. Printer printed the brochure, story over. 1 year later, we are participating in the same event again, but this time that head of communications is not there. She's left us and gone to another company. So the printer tells the CEO that there was some fellow captain over here who was handling this last time. And I was called in and I was told, can you take this on? And I said, yeah, sure, I'll take it on. And I took it on and I found out about, you know, brochure kaise banta hai, looked around, did some research, went to the bigger boys in Mahindra Group, Tech Mahindra, and all of them, asked them, how do you do this? What is the design basis of this, this, that? Had a few friends in advertising, checked with them also this, that, and tried to do a good job with it. And to do that, now I needed not only to go and write, but also understand what the business was. So I understood what ABAB was, what this was, what that was, understood all of that, and then composed this. This was about the time when Mahindra was going through its brand restructuring. And many of you who see this word Mahindra Rise, the word Rise came from that brand restructuring, including the logo and all was changed, for which a team was called from the United States called Strawberry Frog, a very elite team which did that. When Strawberry Frog came in, they said that we need some people from your organization who understand your organization very well. So at that point, they said from the IT sector, who can be there, who can, you know, sort of, you know, this fellow knows about all the different things. And I got into that team. Then I got into another team and to another team. So I told these people that my journey, I mean, I did not know it at that time. It is only when I, in hindsight, reconstruct how the dots connected. The journey of meeting Michael Bloomberg starts with actually correcting somebody else's mistake that you're not supposed to. It's not your job. So I think one of the best ways to create two up, two down is actually to encourage a culture of saying, take up 1.5 portfolio. You're interested in marketing, go here, go attend something. You're good in English literature. Why don't you advise these people who are writing all this crap in LinkedIn, our sales and marketing? Why don't you? And don't ever do this by saying, ke, tumne jo likha hai galat hai. Don't do that. Rewrite that and give it to him. And say, hey, listen, I just thought this might be a better way to, it makes me understand. Your, you know, stuff you've written is superb, but it's technical, not understand. This one, I think, will be understandable. Give it to them and let them take credit for it. Don't do it by saying, okay, and then in one meeting, get up and say, sir, actually, I will. Don't do that. If you do that, you have cut off your chance. I mean, that everybody recognizes what you're trying to do. You're not trying to help. You're trying to show that I'm trying to help. Don't do that. If you do that, I mean, I don't need to tell you that it's a hypocrisy. Nobody will ever buy that. So that's the way to practice two up, two down. Why two up, three up, three, four up, five up? You can practice all of that.
Captain, you have many more books within you, residing in you, right? Waiting to be published. I hope you know that. And, you know, you're so lucidly explaining to us how leadership is a lot about doing and not just, you know, saying.
I learned something from the chief happiness officer of Coke just 3 days ago, which I want to share with you. Right?
Yeah, please.
And she said at the end of the, you know, it was a talk and we were on a panel together. And the end of it, she said that these things that I have shared with you, I can teach you a very simple experiment with which you can assess whether you will be able to do it or not. You've got the gyan, but will you be able to do it or not? And the experiment, you'll have to participate in it. It's really fun. You'll have to participate. So those of you who switched off your cameras, you should switch it on. It'll be a fun experiment to practice, but just switch it on. Yeah. Great. So the experiment involves taking both hands like this. Go on, I'm waiting. Putting the fingers together like that, putting the hand like this, and putting it to your cheek. To your cheek, cheek. You're putting it in the chin. Cheek, cheek. This is cheek. This is chin. Your troops will do what you will do, not what you will say.
True.
So if you practice two up, two down, your troops will practice it.
Great.
But if you say, "Isko kyun hai? Dusre department wala kyun baitha idhar? Usko aane ki zarurat nahi. I'm going to meet the CEO. You don't have to come."
Yeah.
But you should not. So remember this story between the cheek and the chin. Troops will do what you will do, not what you will say, not what you'll ask them to do.
One last question, Captain. We don't have time beyond that. Though I have so many questions, maybe there is some way I can send them to you later. But we have the next session coming up. I heard in one of your Josh talks about how your chooses you and not the other way around. And you also mentioned how all of us have to deal with downtimes and depression. We may not get what we want at the right time, so on and so forth. So what would you, your advice be for the students to deal with the downtimes and, work towards enabling themselves towards the desirable occupations or professions, you know, preparing them rather.
So I know that students, no matter what gyan I give them right now, it'll sound superfluous because they say, I have a challenge, lonely hour, nokri mil rahi hai, but you are giving right. high level gyan. You know, that's fine. Fair point. It's a fair point. It's like giving gyan to a person who's running the marathon while he's running it. It's about, get the hell out of my back, man. I understand that. However, as a construct, I want to share two aspects. The first aspect I want to share is, and this will probably be, like many things in life, a realization will come a few years later.
Hmm.
When athletes are trained, Olympic level athlete, Asiad level athletes are trained, they are taken to high altitude for training. The reason why they are taken to high altitude is because oxygen levels are lower there.
Hmm.
So in the lower oxygen levels, they are made to train. They are made to train under adverse, low oxygen, low metabolism levels, and they are taken to a standard. And when they come back to sea level to participate, their performance is boom, like that. I think the batch of 2020, 2021 have been taken to high altitude. You have been taken to an extremely, by life, not by Great Lakes, but by life, by great, sure. The great guy sitting on top or whatever, or the great China, whichever. There, you have been taken there. Now, in that environment, you have two choices to make. The first choice is you can whine about. And you can, you know, why did it happen in my batch only? Why did it all of that? You can do all of those things. The second is to realize that actually, if it had to happen to you in some point in your life, it's best that it happened to you while you were a student, not yet married, don't have two children, don't have EMI, don't have a, you know, I'm sure many of you have that also. But I'm saying that at a student's level is probably when you're most resilient. You can still survive off vada pav. If you owe somebody money, it doesn't matter so much right now. But imagine if the same situation happening, and as it is indeed happening, it's happening for maybe your elder siblings, it's happening for older people all around you. So I think that is the first point I want to make.
Yeah.
The second is, I did speak about that point that your profession chooses you.
Yeah.
The reason why I made that point is at the age of 20s, we think that we have to make some important choices. We have to make big choices. Mm-hmm. What I want to suggest to you is this subtle nuance different between important and unimportant choices. And what does that mean? So we, at the age of 10th class, have to make a choice, science, commerce, or arts. And usually the choice is made for us. In our time, choice was made for me. You can't get this percentage, automatically you go into that. So you don't have any choice. And very rare that a 90 percentile student, go be Tambram, sir is laughing also. Tambram will go into arts. No way. Science, doctor, engineer, choices are already made. Then when we get into that profession of medicine, again, a choice has to be. Do I take dentistry? Do I take cardiac? These choices constantly we think have to be. I don't think those are the important choices. Though. The important choices are, do we wake up every day and say, whatever task is given to me, I'll find maximum significance in that task. Will I be a good team player to work with? Will I be nice to people? Will I say yes more often than I say no? Will I go out of my way to help people? Will I be true to myself? Will I, if I made a promise, will I stick to it to myself, not to somebody else? If I have said, okay, these are the more important choices. That big choice of taking the right fork or the left fork is not a big choice, because you can be successful in the right road also and the left road also. It doesn't matter. But the small, tiny, tiny choices that you will take, that will I accept this graft or will I accept this bribe? Will I accept this? Will I do that? Will I shirk my duty because the boss is not watching today? These are the choices that will shape you.
Look where you're planted.
Tiny choices will build you as a person. They will become your character. They will become you. Then it doesn't matter which road you are in. If you're in this road also, you'll be a useless fellow. If you have taken useless small choices, that road also, you'll be a useless fellow. So I think it is the small choices that we make, which we make with ourselves, which are the more important choices, rather than that one choice which we make every 3 to 6 years. Science lena hai, phir ye lena hai, phir MNC mein jana hai. Those aren't the choices. The choices that decide where we end up in life are the tiny, tiny, tiny choices that we make.
Well said. Absolutely. So I'm really sorry, students who many questions. I don't have more time to ask.
I have a suggestion, ma'am. What they can do is they can Twitter the question to me.
Great.
I'll be more than happy to try.
We'll do that. You may have read some of these comments here, Captain. Most inspirational speech ever. Thank you very much, sir. And I'm also sad to let you go, but we have to do that in the interest of time. So thank you very much. And we would love to have you on campus whenever time and situation permits to come to a beautiful campus and address all of
us. I'll be more than happy to do that. Thank you very much. And all the
thank you so much. It's been really awesome. Yeah.
Thank you.
Over to you, Surya.
Thank you.